Good day, I'm Norman Wahlberger. We're going through what we are going to call data structures, ways of organizing mathematics into units, into arrangements. There's four main kinds of data structures that we're going to be looking at: lists, ordered sets, multisets, and sets. Each of them has a self-contained, beautiful theory, and then they all end up interacting with each other a little bit later on. So in our last video, we talked about lists. Today, we're going to talk about ordered sets. Ordered sets come about when we decide that we're going to have our data structure with an order as opposed to unordered, and where we decide that we're not going to allow repetitions as opposed to allowing repetitions. So here's an example of an ordered set. Our notation is that when we don't allow repetitions, we use these braces. And when we have something that's ordered, we have commas. If it's unordered, we don't have commas. So this is an unconventional approach to our notation. So in this video, we're going to be talking about ordered sets like this. Sometimes we might shorten that, just say osets. And we'll see that the main object that we're going to be interested in to focus our attention very concretely and specifically are what we can call osets nk. These are k-osets from n, where k and n are natural numbers. And we're going to see that there's an intimate connection between this theory and the theory of the symmetric group, or Sn. Okay, so our non-standard convention for an ordered set that is going to be enclosed in brackets, which are like braces, and repetitions are not going to be allowed, while the elements are separated by commas. And to be specific, we're going to look at n equals 5, when we're just going to be using elements from 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 as the objects that we're going to be trying to organize. So we're going to look at ordered sets, 5k. These are k ordered sets from 5. It means we're going to try to create organized structures which are ordered, which don't have repetitions, and all of the elements that we're going to use are going to be from this little collection right here. And let's also recall our prior agreement that natural numbers for us are only going to be considered in standard or reduced Hindu-Arabic form. So we're only going to use natural numbers written like this. This is the only thing that we're going to allow. So if we want to write a 4, we're going to write it that way. We're not going to allow 3 plus 1. We're not going to allow 4.00. We're not going to allow some description like the number after 3. If you want to express the quantity 4, there's one and only one way that we're going to allow, and that's like this. So we're going to take the approach sort of a computer, okay, where we seriously constrain things so that we know exactly what we're talking about. Okay, so that's what we're going to be talking about today. And we'll see that there's some interesting connections, not only with the symmetric group, but also with ringing church bells. So let's start off by listing some of these ordered sets. We'll start with the simplest or smallest ones. So when k equals 0, we're talking about just an empty set. Braces like this with a space inside. When k equals 1, we're talking about a 1 ordered set. It can only contain one element, and there are these 5 possibilities. When k equals 2, we have these possibilities: 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4, 1, 5, 2, 1, 2, 3, 2, 4, 2, 5, 3, 1, 3, 2, 3, 4, 3, 5, 4, 1, 4, 2, 4, 3, 4, 5, and 5, 1, 5, 2, 5, 3, 5, 4. A total of 20 different possibilities. So we can carry on with k equals 3. Then we get ordered sets that look like this. We can start 1, 2, 3, and then 1, 2, 4, 1, 2, 5, and then maybe bumping up the 2 to get 1, 3, 4, 1, 3, 5, 1, 4, 5. Then we can basically repeat the order: 1, 3, 2, 1, 4, 2, 1, 5, 2. And we make our way eventually to 5, 4, 3. It's not entirely obvious how to best organize these three sets, but this is what they end up looking like, something like this. K equals 4, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 5, 1, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 4, 3, and so on. We keep going till eventually we get to 5, 4, 3, 2. And with K equals 5, well, there's a whole list of them. And the first one, probably 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then eventually 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So we could explicitly list them, but involve a little bit more and more work because the numbers of these things go up as we increase. But this is as far as we go when we're considering osets from 5. If we're only allowed to use the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, then we're not allowed to make any bigger ordered sets, because if we had 6 or more elements, then we would obviously have some repetitions, and we're agreeing that repetitions are not going to be allowed. So the maximum value of k is, in this case, k equals 5. Since after that, we must have repetition. And that's telling us that this particular case, when we have k equals 5, is somehow special. That's the maximum possible size we can get if we restrict ourselves to n equals 5. So there's something a little bit special about this maximal situation here. And in fact, it is a very interesting and important special situation in mathematics. All right, so when we've been listing these ordered sets from 5, we've seen that there's a bit of a puzzle here. How do we actually do this in a systematic, organized way? In particular, how do we do it when we're looking at all 5 permutations? 5 permutations, or 5 ordered sets from 5. Well, it turns out that that question has actually been studied very intensively by church bell ringers. So back in the maybe 1600s in England, there was this tradition that arose of people ringing bells in a concerted kind of orchestrated fashion. And this is called ringing the changes. So let's say, for example, that your church has 3 bells labeled 1, 2, and 3. And so you have 3 people ringing the bells. Boom, boom, boom. Okay, so you can go boom, boom, boom over and over again, but it's a little bit boring. But it's more interesting if you change the order of the bells. So the idea is to look at all possible sequences of 3 bells and try to ring them in such a way that you can work your way through all possible 3 ordered sets from 3. But there's a little bit of a rule here that the bell ringers have adopted, which is that any one bell changes its position in the order by at most 1 in either direction. It doesn't have to change its position, but if it is going to change its position, it can only be at most 1. So if you watch any one bell, say 3, here's how it looks as we go along. It's always moving by a 1. So we're going to go 1, 2, 3, then 2, 1, 3. These basically swap order, and then these swap, and then we have another swap here. So basically we're always swapping adjacent things. And eventually the idea is to get back to the place where you started from, and we've gone through all 6 permutations there. Now, if you have 4 bells, there's more than one way of ringing these changes, going through all of them. But one way of doing it rather systematically that is in fact well known to all bell ringers, it's called plain bob. So it's sort of like bell ringing 101. Is to start with this, say, sequence here, and just add the 4s in the right way. So we start with 1, 2, 3, then put in a 4, and then keep the 1, 2, 3 in its position, and just have the 4 migrate into all possible positions. Once you finish that, then you go to the next one, 2, 1, 3. So you change the 1, 2, 3 to a 2, 1, 3, and then the 4 migrates back to all possible positions, and then the 2, 1, 3 switches to 2, 3, 1, and then back and forth the 4s go. And this way you can systematically go through all 24 4 permutations from 4. So it takes some skill and some practice and some memorization and understanding of permutations for a dedicated team of bell ringers to go through such a sequence very carefully, and making sure that nobody goes out of place, and making sure that you cover all the permutations. And of course, the more bells you have, the more interesting and rich a story this is. For example, I think the world record in terms of going through all the changes for a set number of bells is 8 bells. Okay, that took probably more than a day, and was done in England not that long ago, I mean maybe in the early 60s. So there's, in fact, more than one way of doing this, of going through a system, and bell ringers have elaborate kind of methods for doing this in sort of a whole little world. Very interesting. In fact, there's chapters in Australia and New Zealand, probably other English-speaking countries too. Whether in continental Europe there are bell ringers that go through this kind of system, I'm not sure. Maybe some of you can tell us. So in any case, long before the mathematical theory of permutations got going, that was really maybe probably 18th and 19th century business, the bell ringers were very well versed with permutations and the subtleties of them. So the ordered sets NN, where we have all of the elements 1 through N ordered in some particular way. These particular ordered sets are very important and special because they connect with the rich theory of permutations and the theory of the symmetric group SN. So for example, if we have this particular ordered set 3, 1, 2, 5, 4 from oset 5, 5, that can be associated to a permutation. So permutations have different ways of being expressed in mathematics. Here's one way of expressing such a thing. We write the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and below them we write the numbers in our order set 3, 1, 2, 5, 4. And we can think about this as a motion, for example, where the number 1 goes to the position 3, the number 2 goes to the position 1, the thing in the third position goes to 2, the thing in the fourth position goes to 5, the thing in the fifth position goes to 4. Another way of visualizing such a permutation might be in this way here, with a kind of a braid-like diagram. These are positions 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So this is sort of before and after. So 1 goes to 3 is represented by this string that goes from position 1 to position 3. Here we have 2 going to 1, 3 going to 2, 4 going to 5, and 5 going to 4. Yet another way of expressing such a permutation is to sort of follow what happens to one particular one. So 1 is going to go to 3, and then 3 is going to go to 2, and then 2 is going to go to 1, so we close off that and call that a cycle. And 4 goes to 5, and 5 goes to 4, so there's another cycle. This is called cycle notation for the permutation. It's another way of visualizing or writing down or expressing a permutation. What makes permutations so important is that they also have an algebraic structure. We can combine two permutations to get another permutation. This is in the same kind of spirit as we combining lists, as we talked about last time, but it's quite different in the sense that in this case, if you take two permutations of a given size, when you multiply them, you get another permutation of exactly the same size. And so the set of permutations of a given size forms a closed algebraic structure, which we call the symmetric group. So here's how we do that. So here's a permutation, actually the one that we looked at on the previous page. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 3, 1, 2, 5, 4. And here's another permutation, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 2, 4, 3, 5, 1. So how would we combine these? Well, we would get a third permutation. The way we figure out what that is we say, all right, if we apply this one, then the 1 goes to 3. And then if we apply this one, the 3 goes to 3. So altogether, the 1 goes to 3. How about the 2? 2 goes to 1 under this permutation, and then applying the next permutation, 1 goes to 2. So altogether, 2 goes to 2. 3 goes to 2 under the first permutation, and then 2 goes to 4 under the second permutation, so the combined effect of that is to send 3 to 4. 4 goes to 5, 5 goes to 1, so altogether 4 goes to 1. And 5 goes to 4, and then 4 goes to 5, so altogether 5 goes to 5. All right, and this is a very pleasant way of combining permutations, and we can transfer that to a multiplication of ordered sets. So we might as well multiply this ordered set by this ordered set to give us the ordered set 3, 2, 4, 1, 5. All right, so this is a very interesting and important structure in mathematics that connects with lots of things. But it's a little bit more of an advanced topic, so we're not going to go much further right now. We'll talk about this at a later point. But the main idea is that when we're considering these data structures, the data structure of an ordered set is actually a very rich subject, which contains within it this vast field, study of permutations and the symmetric group. In our next video, we're going to look at the third kind of data structure on our list, which is multisets. This structure doesn't get as much press, perhaps, as it deserves. It's quite an interesting thing, which has some interesting and, in fact, curious aspects, which I think you'll enjoy. So next time, multisets. Hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wahlberger. Thanks for listening.